delicious, succulent, moist. It is nutritious and it goes with every meal. Breakfast, how about some meat from this magical animal over here? Lunch, meat has got you covered. Dinner, more of the same, please.
Meat has been an important part of Western life for decades. It is simultaneously a status symbol and a bountiful source of much of what we think the human body needs to grow and prosper. However, meat's place at the top of the pyramid of what the Western world values, alongside straight white men and the original Star Wars trilogy, has begun to shrink rapidly in recent years.
The rise into the mainstream of vegetarianism and veganism is emblematic of this. Veganism isn't a particularly new phenomenon. The Vegan Society in the UK was founded in November of 1944, but even before that, the opposition to the exploitation of animals, particularly dairy animals, on ethical grounds was being made in the early 19th century by Dr. William Lamb and Percy Bysshe Shelley. As we enter the third decade of the 21st century, veganism has exploded in visibility and mainstream acceptance. Global data found that the number of consumers who identified as vegan grew from 1% in 2014 to 6% in 2017, a 600% increase. It is a phenomenon that doesn't restrict itself to the supposed health benefits to vegan and vegetarian lifestyles. There are a range of moral and ethical reasons why a person would choose to become vegetarian or full vegan. As is the way of things, there was and is backlash to these new ways of living, tending towards the opposite extreme, ranging from an elimination of all processed foods to perhaps the extremest of extreme dietary choices, cutting out everything apart from honest, red, juicy, dripping, luscious red meat.
Sorry, I got carried away there for a second.
Like veganism, these types of diets aren't that new either. The paleo diet was first promoted by Dr. Walter L. Vauquelin in his book The Stone Age Diet from 1975, but the more extreme so-called carnivore diet, the consumption of animal products exclusively, is a relatively new one, peaking its blood-slicked muzzle into the diet discourse around the end of 2017, the most well-known proponent being Koff Dr. Sean Baker. At the beginning of 2019, he had 60,000 followers on something called... and regularly posts anecdotal stories from his followers detailing frankly miraculous and, dare I say, perilous stories of weight loss as a result of his diet.
So, this is the state of affairs in the diet world at the end of 2019. Sure, there are shades of grey, but in terms of popular, perhaps even populist diet regimes, you have the paleo slash carnivore diet at one end, while at the other you have vegetarianism and veganism. And this is all fine, right? I mean, you pick a side, you do you, whatever works, that's great. And normally, this is not a side of life that I'm very into. I mean, look at me. My own diet consists of curry from Aldi and lasagna from Aldi, with sausage rolls from Aldi thrown in as a sort of garnish. That is, I am not joking, quite a typical week for me. But there is one side of the discussion surrounding all of these diet regimes that does interest me, and that is the language used when talking about the human body and food. So that is what we're going to talk about today. We're going to find out how discussions surrounding meat are framed, look at some of the arguments that do or do not support these claims, and then talk about why passions run so high when it comes to the simple pleasures of 10 ounces of the red stuff.
Are humans supposed to eat meat? Seems a reasonable question. It is direct, it's balanced, and this is a problem that persists throughout the discourse surrounding diet. The language is deliberately imprecise and obfuscatory, try saying that three times quickly, and really works against the science behind the way that the human body has evolved and adapted in a myriad of ways over hundreds of thousands of years. Phrases such as supposed to and meant to, along with the toe-curlingly sloppy designed to, invoke a sense of morality behind diets and food that, biologically speaking, really have no space in the discussion. So, let's start with the biology. This is the skull of an omnivore, and incidentally a visualization of how I felt after seeing The Rise of Skywalker. The teeth are relatively small, with flat, spade-like incisors at the front, good for scooping up food into the oral cavity and stopping it from, you know, spilling out everywhere. Very small canines at the sides for cutting, and then rows of flat molars running towards the back. The teeth are spaced very close together, which creates a nice surface for grinding stuff on. The bottom set of teeth are set into a jaw which is hinged to allow both up and down as well as left and right motion, which again helps with grinding food between the molars. If we look at the skull of a purely carnivorous animal, we can see that almost everything about it is completely different. This is the skull of a fox. Already we can see that the opening is much larger than that of a human, which is helpful for an animal that needs to be able to catch and kill prey with its mouth. There are incisors, but they are much less pronounced compared to the huge dagger-like canines, excellent for tearing and shredding flesh, and the jagged molars running towards the back of the mouth acting kind of like huge knives. You'll notice that there is quite a lot of space between the teeth relative to the human skull, which is so that stringy meat doesn't get caught between the teeth. The jawbone doesn't move laterally either, which explains why carnivores don't really chew bits of meat, rather just tear huge chunks and swallow them whole.
Which brings me neatly to saliva. Saliva is completely different between carnivores and herbivores and omnivores. The saliva of carnivorous animals does not contain enzymes that help with digestion, all of that action happening inside their stomachs and small intestine. This is not true of herbivores who begin the digestion process in the mouth, I beg your pardon, oral cavity, by mixing food with saliva, which contains carbohydrate digesting enzymes such as amylase.
The party then moves down to the stomach, and guess what? Stomach chemistry is, again, completely different between carnivores and herbivores and omnivores. A carnivore's stomach acid needs to be pretty strong in order to destroy any harmful bacteria and provide the right conditions for protein digestion, and sits around about 1.5 on the pH scale. Herbivores, as a result of the pre-digestion that goes on in the oral cavity and a lower exposure to dangerous pathogens, have much weaker levels of stomach acid, sitting at around 5 on the pH scale.
So, looking purely at the biology, where does this leave us humans? Well, we certainly do not display all of the qualities of the carnivore when you look at our skull and our teeth, and when you look at our stubby, blunt fingers, it's hard to argue that these things could ever have been expected to shred hide from flesh, so I guess we're herbivores. Don't eat meat, it's not natural. See you next time, guys. I finally finished Red Dead now, so I can actually start talking about the game. Okay. Really, humans are omnivores. We display characteristics of both carnivores with the high levels of acidity in our stomachs and our admittedly small canines, and herbivores with our flat molars and comparatively long guts and, you know, the fact that most raw meat will kill us or at least make us really, really regret that visit to City Fish Bar and Kebab on Friday night, and the numerous studies that link red meat consumption to cancer, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, prostate cancer, breast cancer, a higher mortality rate in general, coronary heart disease, stroke, and oh god, I'm doing it again, aren't I? The binary way in which the human meat question is almost always framed is kind of moot, and is a tactic used by people on both sides of the debate to oversimplify the science and back up their own point of view. As with most things, reality is a lot more complex. Very little evidence presented in this debate speaks about the really complex science in humans, for instance, our ability to synthesize certain key amino acids and vitamins, and here be dragons, because even dipping a toe into the murky waters of amino acid synthesis throws up so many terms and definitions and lalanines that I had to call upon a very clever friend to help me grasp the basics of this corner of human biology, and this is what she had to say.
Amino acids are extremely important because they are the building blocks for proteins. Proteins perform many roles within the human body, not just building muscle. For example, they are antibodies in the immune system. They catalyze many reactions within the body, such as digestion in the form of enzymes. They act in roles like hemoglobin carrying oxygen around the body. And they are hormones like insulin. Of the 20 amino acids that are used to build proteins in the human body, there are 10 that are considered to be essential amino acids and 10 that are non-essential. Now, the non-essential amino acids aren't called that because we do not need them. We definitely need them to build proteins, but they are able to be synthesized within the human body from intermediates of major metabolic pathways, so we don't need to get them from food. The essential amino acids, on the other hand, the human body cannot synthesize and create on its own, so we have to get them from food. They're not called essential because they are more important than the non-essential ones, simply that they are more important to get within your diet. Confusingly, one of the essential amino acids, arginine, we actually can synthesize, we just aren't able to synthesize enough of it. And one of the non-essential amino acids, tyrosine, although we synthesize it, we have to synthesize it from another amino acid, which we cannot make. So this split between essential and non-essential is not black and white. There are actually many shades of grey.
Right. Enough of my science and measurable, observable facts. There is a very large and very vocal section of the community that eats meat, loads of it in fact, to the exclusion of all else. And they're doing fine, apparently. But I'm a rational thinker. I'm not in the business of strawmanning people here. Let's go straight to the top and see what their leaders have to say about their own interpretations of the carnivore-only diet.
This, for those of you blessed with ignorance, is Jordan Berndt Peterson. He has a PhD in clinical psychology from McGill University and is a professor of psychology at the University of Toronto. His YouTube channel has 1.8 million subscribers and he has achieved, let us say, notoriety in recent years for his political views and opinions. What is important for this video is that Peterson likes to paint himself as a man of science, of reason, of rational thought. He wrote a book about how humans construct meaning and beliefs in 1999 called Maps of Meaning, The Architecture of Belief, in which he writes, "We act, even instruct, and yet do not understand. How can we do what we cannot explain?" He wrote a second book in 2018 called 12 Rules for Life, An Antidote to Chaos, the seventh rule of which being, pursue what is meaningful, not what is expedient. Peterson attracted attention in the middle of 2018 when he went on the Joe Rogan podcast and talked about his new carnivore-only diet.
And how do we imagine this doctor of clinical psychology, a working professor at the University of Toronto, with a large body of work emphasising rational thought and empirical research, and an audience of millions, frame his miraculous new diet?
Okay, so I want to preface that with something. I am not a dietary expert, so I'm now speaking as an uninformed citizen. Disclaimer number two, I am not recommending this to anyone. I don't know what the hell I'm talking about. Clinical studies with diet are virtually impossible to conduct. Yes. Turns out if you don't eat carbohydrates, you don't need vitamin C. Huh, who would have guessed that?
How does that work?
I don't remember. But they should be incredulous. Like when people make absurd claims, it's like, oh, well, I had 50 health problems and I stopped eating everything but meat and they went away. It's like, oh, sure.
Yes. Yes, it's so sure, Jordan. You're supposed to be a man of science and you criticize people for believing what they do without evidence. And then you go on a podcast and say, I had all these things wrong with me, but then I cut out everything but meat and I'm fine now. Them's the breaks, I guess. Oh, and also I had a glass of apple cider once and then didn't sleep for a month. Diet is weird, am I right? For all of Peterson's lampshading, Rogan does make a commendable effort to press Peterson on what he is saying, gently correcting him on some things, being stern on some other things, and broadly trying to suggest that it is more about what the carnivore diet cuts out, the refined sugar, the processed meat, etc., rather than what it actually is that is actually beneficial. And there is a point after Peterson has been talking about all the incredible effects of his meat-only diet for really quite a while, where Rogan goes, "And you've done no blood work." And it's an incredible puncture moment where all the air leaks from Peterson's balloon, and he has to admit that he has no actual numbers to back up what he is saying. And then at the end of the interview, he pretty much admits that the diet will eventually kill him.
Well, certainly, eventually this diet will kill me.
Moving swiftly on, this is Sean Baker, an orthopaedic surgeon who was struck off in 2017 and reinstated in 2019, and bodybuilder who moved to the carnivore diet in late 2016 and has done more to popularise it than even Peterson himself. His Instagram is full of posts like this one, which are pointless because Sean doesn't provide a link to, you know, actually read the article that is being cited, and self-defeating because reading around the subject of oxidative stress eventually brings you to this article, which I have linked to because I'm not a hack, which suggests that, yes, a diet high in carbohydrates does increase the occurrence of oxidative stress and thus the chance of obesity and other related diseases, but also suggests that diets high in animal proteins, diets like, say, ones which involve 100% animal products, are just as likely to have the same effect. Whoopsie, Sean. Oh, sorry, I meant Dr. Sean. A quick canter through his YouTube channel shows him creating videos from the icy void of space itself. This one, uploaded on the 30th of December, is the first I saw, and is mainly him reading posts on his Instagram account before finishing up on a story about athletes in California being too skinny to compete at a college football level. And this from a man who regularly receives testimonials from people gushing about how much weight they have lost through his carnivore diet. Oh, and then he says that vegans are suboptimal as human beings.
If you don't mind being suboptimal, inferior as a human, you know, not reaching your genetic potential, not really reaching your physical potential, go be vegan.
Baker also went on the Joe Rogan show to talk about his new diet, and throughout the interview he uses words and phrases like as a scientist and looking at things scientifically or as a physician or I am literally just making this up as I go, how have you let me get this far? There is a point where he straight up says,
I think you have to
You know, be really clinical about it.
And then he talks about people who go on low carb and ketogenic diets.
The big problem, because people will go on low carb diets or ketogenic diets, and they'll say, "I feel the best I've ever felt in my life. I mean, my mood is better, my mental cognition is better, my joints feel better, my guts don't hurt, my skin is better, my sex drive is better." Everything you would say is that means you're getting healthy, and they'll go to their doctor and they'll get some blood drawn, and their cholesterol will be high. And the doctor will say, "Well, you're going to kill yourself. You're going to have a heart attack," right? So people get scared away from that, and they go back to eating their other stuff, and then they feel crappy again. But they're like, "Well, at least my cholesterol is not bad."
And this whole bit is framed in such a way that a person's feelings, how they feel about their health, are more valuable than, you know, observable scientific results, which is odd from someone who ostensibly values taking an objective approach to things and who is also a medical professional, apparently. He actually seems to have a particular problem with test results in general.
We have so gotten away from just defining what's healthy. You know, if somebody comes into your office and you say, you know, you talk to them for 2-3 minutes, because healthcare is just, you got 10 minutes to see a patient, make a decision. So what you're going to do is like, "Hi, how you doing?" Order a bunch of labs. You look at the results of the labs and say, "Okay, this lab's low, this lab's high, this lab's normal. Go on this drug, or, you know, do this or that." And the patient may be saying, "Well, but I feel great." Or maybe converse, they may say, "I feel like crap." Well, you look, your labs look fine, so go exercise a little bit.
Well, let me bring you back to the beginning. So you're a physician, right?
And then he goes on a bit more before Joe Gainley dives in and basically gives him a second chance to explain the rationale behind carnivorous eating and the supposed health benefits. Joe is actually pretty great in these interviews, both with Baker and Peterson. He is continually pressing, not trying to gotcha these people per se, but trying to manoeuvre these people into a place where they have to come clean about their methods and where exactly they are getting their data from. At one point, Rogan brings up people in the extreme northern parts of the globe, particularly the Inuit, who he points out have...
They had an extremely low incidence of cancer.
Which, apart from the fact that the cancer thing isn't actually true, lung cancer rates in Inuit men and women are the highest in the world, and the death rates from strokes in both Inuit men and women is twice as that for all Canadians, neatly leads me onto the one study, perhaps the most well-known study, that attempts to formally examine the effects of a meat-only diet.
This is Vilhjalmur Stefansson. Apart from having a difficult to pronounce name, in his day Stefansson was a world-famous anthropologist, showman and explorer. He was a key figure in the mapping of the Arctic, receiving a Founders Gold Medal from the Royal Geographical Society in 1921 for his efforts exploring the region. His experiences in the Arctic led him to write a book called The Friendly Arctic, and over 11 years of exploration, Stefansson estimated that he spent 9 of those years on a meat-only diet. In 1928, he and a colleague, one K. Anderson, lived in New York for a year, surviving on a diet of animal produce only, including the lean and fatty parts of beef, veal, pork and chicken, specifically the muscle, liver, kidney, brain, bone marrow, bacon and fat. Except for certain observation periods, the men could eat as much as they wanted, and proportion the lean to the fatty meat as they wanted. Stefansson averaged 0.81 of a kilo a day, while Anderson averaged 0.79 of a kilo. They were allowed coffee, black tea, meat broth and water, averaging 2 litres of fluid a day. The study is fascinating and goes into great detail about the subjects' nutrition, how much weight they lost, their blood pressure, their mental state throughout, and their general levels of activity while they're on the diet itself. I'll link the study in the description so you can read the results and findings, but I'll go ahead and pick out a few key ones for myself. Finding the first. At the end of the year, the subjects were mentally alert, physically active, and showed no specific physical changes in any system of the body. Finding the second. During the first week, all 3 men lost weight due to a shift in the water content of the body. Thereafter, their weights remained practically constant. Finding the third. Vitamin deficiencies did not appear. And finally, finding the fourth, the clinical observations and laboratory studies gave no evidence that any ill effects had occurred from the prolonged use of the exclusive meat diet.
I'm sure there are doubters out there that will at this point be saying, but the subjects were allowed to go home, surely they must have cheated. Well, the authors of the study, Walter S. McClellan and Eugene F. Dubois, have got you covered. Firstly, they point out that subjects were under close observation during a large part of the intensive studies. In every individual specimen of urine which was tested during the intervals when they were living at home, acetone bodies were present in amounts so constant that fluctuations in the carbohydrate intake were practically ruled out. And finally, the high character of the subjects is a guarantee that they faithfully followed the prescribed diet. So, they were watched. Their urine was sampled, and they're just jolly good chaps, what?
So I guess that all puts me in my place then. Stephenson and Anderson showed no physical effects at all from a year of eating purely animal produce. Apart from the nausea, diarrhea and constipation, poor appetite, abdominal discomfort, vomiting and fucking pneumonia, of course.
And then there's the tiny little detail of the entire study being founded by the American Institute of Meatpackers. That's right. Because there is no conflict of interest in a study examining the benefits of an all-meat diet being funded by an organisation that deals with the logistics of moving that meat around the country. But hey, corking good fellows, am I right? So, I guess this is where the conclusion happens. In researching this video, I've learned a lot about meat itself, some of the misconceptions around meat, some of the inaccuracies that are made when reporting on meat's health benefits or absence thereof. I've learned a lot about science and biology, canines, molars, acid levels, the expensive tissue hypothesis, but I haven't really gotten to the root of exactly why we cling to meat eating so strongly, as if the right to eat flesh is some divine right that we have earned over thousands of years of opportunistic scavenging and gradually gratuitous butchery.
People are so desperate that their desire for meat is justified that otherwise objective scientific figures are reduced to basically arguing that, well, if it ain't broke. People who would otherwise tear people down for being too emotional, ignoring facts, or however else you want to phrase it, go on podcasts watched by millions of people and say, you know, I feel this to be true. I'm not saying do it, but this is what people who have done it are telling me.
This is my opinion now, but it seems to me that the desire, the feeling that humans have a right to eat meat is an emotional one, not a scientific one, or one that seems to be actively promoted by many scientific publications. Meat, and red meat specifically, it's always red meat, is this kind of line in the sand, where beyond which a small but vocal community of people are not prepared to pass. Red meat is a very emotive commodity. It is tied up with images of prosperity, of success, of masculinity, definitely. And I think for certain people, their world is changing in ways that feel out of their control. A control that has been enjoyed by them and people like them for a long time. And one that they aren't going to let go of lightly. They are told to do less of the things that they like doing. Driving their cars, going on foreign holidays, exercising their idea of what freedom of speech is. They have to share power with new people, share their spaces, both physical and digital, share their wealth, share everything that they have been told all through their lives is theirs, and that they deserve it. Meat eating is a kind of last bastion that they cling to. It's one thing that can't be taken away from them, because it's their body, right? It's their decision what they do with it, right? And it affects no one else, right?
Hello, good afternoon. Welcome to the BBC News at One. Scientists have issued their starkest warning yet about the
planet's lungs. The organ through which the world breathes.
American firefighters have been killed while helping to battle Australia's bushfires.
Scientists are more confident than ever that the impacts of climate change are playing out now in the severity and frequency of droughts, storms and other extreme weather events.
The planet's on fire.